Well, thank you all for coming. I'm Vic Reiman. I'm the museum technician here at the Montana Historical Society. This evening, I'm going to talk about the beginnings of the Montana cattle industry and the open range years of the early 1880s. I got interested in the open range over 10 years ago when I first read the book, We Pointed Them North, by old-time Montana cowboy Teddy Blue Abbott. And perhaps some of you have read that book. 6 years ago, I researched Teddy Blue, and this research led me to wonder just what kinds of cattle were on the open range and where did they come from. Tonight, we will meet the familiar Texas Longhorns, but along the way, we will also encounter some less familiar types of cattle, which may surprise you. In less than 40 years, the Montana cattle industry grew from a modest beginning in the southwestern valleys, expanded onto the western edge of the Great Plains, then exploded to stock and overstock nearly all of the eastern prairies, only to collapse after one terrible winter. The story of the rise and fall of this open range cattle industry is a tale of short-sightedness and greed, but also of great courage and resourcefulness. I'd like to share this story with you all this evening. During the mid-19th century, a major corridor of migration, then commonly called the Emigrant Road, ran across what is now southern Wyoming and Idaho. Now today, we think of this travel route as simply the Oregon Trail. But persecuted Mormons seeking sanctuary at Salt Lake City and California gold seekers and settlers traveled this corridor along with the settlers bound for Oregon. Many of these travelers herded along with them large numbers of purebred English American cattle, particularly shorthorns, which are sometimes called Durhams. Shorthorn cattle were unique in that they were dual purpose. That is, the shorthorn cows were good milk producers, but the breed also produced excellent beef. And I'm sure you can appreciate why these dual purpose cattle were especially valued by settlers seeking to establish new homes in Oregon, California, and Utah. By the time the travelers on the Emigrant Road reached Fort Bridger in what is now southwest Wyoming, many of their excellent cattle had lost weight and were footsore from walking nearly 1,000 miles from the jumping off places in Missouri and Nebraska. The Montana cattle industry was born in the summer of 1850 when Richard Grant, a former employee of the Hudson's Bay Company, began trading on a branch of the Emigrant Road in northeast Utah for the worn-out cattle of the Mormon emigrants. Grant and his sons herded these cattle, which included work oxen, north some 400 miles into the Beaverhead Valley of what is now southwest Montana. In the Beaverhead Valley, the Grants' cattle were rested and rehabilitated on the nutritious grasses of the valley. The next summer, the Grants herded their rehabilitated cattle back to the Emigrant Road and traded them again. The usual trade was for the Grants to receive 2 jaded animals from the emigrants for 1 rehabilitated one. Soon the other residents of southwest Montana began this type of trading on the Emigrant Road, so that by the end of the 1850s there were numerous herds of high-quality English-American cattle with a large degree of shorthorn blood in the western Montana valleys. Also in the 1850s, Oregon settlers established large herds of cattle with a shorthorn heritage in the area of the Columbia River Basin, where the states of Oregon, Washington, and Idaho now converge. These herds originated from the cattle that traversed the Emigrant Road with the Oregon-bound settlers. And the cattle in these herds also had a small amount of Spanish blood, resulting from friendly encounters between the cattle of the American settlers and the California Longhorn cattle they met in Oregon. The English had transported the California Longhorns to the Oregon country by sea in the 1700s to provide a source of beef for their Hudson's Bay Company fur trading posts. The California Longhorns were descended from cattle the Spanish had brought to the New World, and they were nearly identical in appearance to the more familiar Texas Longhorns. The hybrid that resulted from the interbreeding of the American settlers' cattle with the California Longhorns became known to Montana stockmen as simply Oregon cattle. Since they had only a small amount of Longhorn blood, the Oregon cattle closely resembled their Shorthorn progenitors and thus were highly valued for the excellent beef they produced. The Longhorns' heritage may have added a degree of hardiness. In the 1860s, Oregon cattle became another source of high-quality stock for the western Montana valleys. In the 1880s, Oregon cattle would become very important in the stocking of the Montana prairies. The arrival of thousands of gold seekers into western Montana in the early 1860s created a huge demand for beef at almost any price. To augment local herds, beef suppliers like future cattle magnate Conrad Coors had cattle herded in from the Columbia Basin, from Utah and California, and even from the Midwest to meet the demand for beef, thus expanding the sources of supply for the growing Montana cattle industry. In late 1866, Nelson Story arrived in southwest Montana with a small herd of Longhorn cattle he had purchased in central Texas and driven north. These were the first Texas Longhorns brought into Montana. Near the end of their 1,500-mile cattle drive, Story and his men had moved their cattle north through central Wyoming on the Bozeman Trail, at great peril to themselves and their cattle and against the wishes of the Army. The Bozeman Trail ran through the prime hunting grounds of the Lakota Sioux, the Cheyenne, the Arikara, and under the leadership of Red Cloud, these tribes waged a guerrilla war to close the trail into three forts that protected it. The Fort Laramie Treaty of 1868 closed the Bozeman Trail. By its terms, all of central and eastern Wyoming north of the North Platte River was closed to white incursions. The Indians quickly burned the army forts to the ground, sort of a celebration barbecue, I suppose, and Nelson Story's dangerous cattle herding feat was not repeated. However, pioneering Wyoming cattlemen began stocking the area south of the North Platte River with Texas Longhorns. These animals were the vanguard of the Texas herds that would eventually stock the prairies all the way into Canada. But the Indian presence north of the Platte would almost completely stop their northward progress for a decade. The completion of the Union Pacific Railroad across southern Wyoming in 1869 made it possible for the first time for the cattlemen of Montana Territory to ship their cattle to Midwestern markets by rail. Unfortunately, rail transport was expensive. To save paying for railroad mileage, Montana cattlemen began herding their cattle to railheads in southeast Wyoming or even western Nebraska. They used an indirect route south through what is now eastern Idaho and then east along the route of the Emigrant Road. Herding by a more direct route southeast across the prairies of Montana and Wyoming was not possible because these prairies were frequented by several tribes of Indians, and besides, northern Wyoming was closed to non-Indians by the Fort Laramie Treaty. About the same time as the completion of the Union Pacific, Montana stockmen such as Conrad Coors, Bob Ford, and Dan Flowery began pasturing herds of cattle in the Sun River Valley along the western edge of the Great Plains. After the January 1870 Baker Massacre broke the military will of the Piegan Blackfeet, Montana cattlemen felt safe to stock a number of river valleys close to the Rocky Mountains. Most of the cattle they herded out from the western valleys and onto the edge of the prairie were of nearly pure English American bloodlines, but there were also herds of Texas Longhorns that some Montana cattlemen had brought into the western valleys in the late 1860s by that long route north through eastern Idaho. Into the late 1870s, cattle raising in Montana was limited to the western valleys and the western edge of the prairies of the territory. The eastern prairies were home to free-roaming Indians and to hundreds of thousands of buffalo that they depended upon for survival. There was still no convenient access to rail transport. These impediments to cattle ranching in the eastern reaches of the territory were about to be removed. The military defeat of the Sioux and Cheyenne in the winter of 1877 and their subsequent relocation to reservations or flight to Canada cleared the way for herds of Texas Longhorns to be driven north across Wyoming and directly into eastern Montana. In his 1940 book, The Longhorns, eminent Texas historian J. Frank Dobie described the Longhorn cattle the Texans herded. These cattle have heavy fore and light hind quarters, thick necks, large coarse heads, and unusually sharp horns. They were light-bodied and very quick and agile on foot. They were products of a land where forage was not especially abundant. Hardiness, a fighting maternal instinct, and ability to thrive under primitive conditions were their chief recommendations. However he might appear, with his steel hooves, his long legs, his stag-like muscles, his thick skin, his mighty horns, the Longhorn could walk the roughest ground, climb the highest hill, swim the widest river, fight the fiercest panther. He was the cow brute for his time. When the first Texas herds arrived in the early 1880s, there were still thousands of buffalo roaming eastern Montana. But the removal of the Indians had made it safe for the hide hunters to begin their grim work, and soon the buffalo were almost completely gone. Granville Stewart served in the 1880s as the foreman and part owner of the DHS Ranch in central Montana. More than 30 years later, he described in his autobiography the drastic change on the Montana range in the early 1880s. In 1880, the country was practically uninhabited. One could travel for miles without seeing so much as a trapper's bivouac. Thousands of buffalo darkened the rolling plains. There were deer, antelope, elk, wolves, and coyotes on every hill and in every ravine and thicket. In the whole territory of Montana, there were but 250,000 head of cattle, including dairy cattle and work oxen. And then he goes on. In the fall of 1883, there was not one buffalo remaining on the range, and the antelope, elk, and deer were indeed scarce. And there were 600,000 head of cattle on the range. Construction of the Northern Pacific Railroad was advancing up the Yellowstone Valley by 1881, and railheads for loading and unloading cattle were built at strategic points along the way. The completion of the Northern Pacific in 1883 made it possible for the Montana stockmen to easily ship cattle from the range to the Midwestern packing plants, and also for him to receive cattle shipped to him from points both east and west. During the early 1880s, in the rush to fill the newly opened ranges of eastern Montana, hundreds of herds of Texas Longhorns poured in from the south, while tens of thousands of Oregon cattle were herded or transported by rail from the west, and thousands of purebred Midwestern cattle rode the rails into the territory from the east. Now, I think it's worth noting here that bulls being bulls, these types of cattle did not stay distinct once they were turned onto the range, and that over several generations, a hodgepodge hybrid called simply range cattle resulted. With the stocking of the ranges of eastern Montana came the full-scale use of the open range system, which had originated in Mexico and had been refined in Texas. As millions of Longhorn cattle were herded north out of Texas after the Civil War to stock the western Great Plains, the open range system had been adopted as a means of managing them. Now, put very simply, under the open range system, cattle were first branded to show their ownership and then released onto a range which was usually defined by its drainage boundaries. Cattle of several owners mixed together on the range so that each year several cooperative roundups were staged to sort out the cattle. The spring roundup was held to establish ownership of the year's calves and then brand them, while the fall beef roundup picked out mature animals to be sent to market. In the fall of 1883, it was generally recognized by veteran Montana cattlemen that the prairies were fully stocked with some 600,000 head of cattle on the range. Yet 3 years later, in the fall of 1886, there were, by Granville Stewart's estimate, some 1 million cattle in the territory, and more herds continued to come in. Common sense had become a victim of the beef boom, or beef bonanza, as it was sometimes called. Now, part of the genesis of the beef boom was that during the 1860s, the number of cattle in the United States, exclusive of its territories, had declined in proportion to the United States population. This resulted in a sharp rise in the price of beef, thus creating a demand for cheaper beef. Raising cattle on the western prairies, newly emptied of buffalo and of Indians, offered the perfect solution to high-priced beef. Enterprising cattlemen soon figured out that they could acquire cattle from Texas for almost nothing, raise them on the public land of the western ranges with only minimal expenses, such as for a ranch house, a branding iron, some corrals, and a few cowboys. The meatpacking plants of Kansas City, Omaha, Chicago, and St. Paul did their part, and the nation's expanded network of railroads was there to transport live cattle from the range to the packing plants, and also to deliver packed fresh beef from the Midwestern plants to retailers all over the eastern U.S. And periodicals and books got in on the act, too. Here's what the Denver Journal of Commerce had to say in 1883. A good-sized steer, when it is fit for the butcher market, will bring $45 to $60. The same animal, at its birth, was worth but $5. He has run on the plains and cropped the grass from the public domain for 4 or 5 years, and now, with scarcely any expense to his owner, is worth $40 more than when he started on his pilgrimage. 1,000 of these animals are kept nearly as cheaply as a single one. So, with 1,000 as a starter and with an investment of about $5,000 in the start, in 4 years, the stock raiser is made from $40,000 to $45,000. Now, I think that's about a 200% annual estimated profit on investment. Pretty good. Published in 1881, the book The Beef Bonanza, or How to Get Rich on the Plains, did much to promote open-range cattle raising. The Beef Bonanza's author, James Brisbane, had served as a career Army officer at many Western posts. This service had given him a chance to observe and study stock raising in the West. In his book, he extolled the promise of large profits, almost guaranteed from raising cattle on the plains, and advised his readers that there is little difference between the climate of the plains and of the Atlantic coast. In his book, Brisbane cited estimates of annual profits on capital invested as high as 50 to 55%. The Beef Bonanza reads like a prospectus for an open-range cattle raising business, and indeed, Brisbane himself speculated in the Montana cattle raising industry. So, with periodicals and books forecasting spectacular profits from stock raising on the Western public domain, the beef boom started because investors in Scotland, England, France, and the Eastern United States wanted in on the spectacular profits and poured in their investment money. In Wyoming, corporations formed in Scotland started new cattle companies or purchased existing ones. The biggest was the Swan Land and Cattle Company, which ultimately ran some 120,000 cattle. In Montana, the pattern was for these outside speculators simply to invest in cattle companies that already existed or in companies moving into Montana from outside, such as the Niobrara Cattle Company, which had been established in Texas and then Nebraska and moved some of its cattle operations onto the eastern Montana ranges starting in the early 1880s. Typically, investors in cattle companies received yearly dividends of 15% and higher on their investments. Because it was almost impossible to count the actual number of animals in a herd spread over hundreds of square miles of open range and mixed in with the animals belonging to others, it was common during the beef boom for herds of cattle to be bought and sold on book count. Book count was calculated by starting with the number of animals purchased, which was perhaps wildly overstated itself because it was also a book count, adding to this count by estimating natural increase and decreasing the count by an estimated factor of loss from winter mortality, predation, and other causes such as miring and eating poisonous plants. It was widely recognized that book counts were almost always overstated, but during the beef boom, these overestimated counts were thought to be inconsequential because of the huge profits to be made in spite of the buying and selling of cattle that didn't exist. John Clay, who had served in Wyoming as an overseer and ranch manager for a Scottish corporation, had this to say about the use of book count in buying range cattle. "It was a gamble in which the dealer always won. You can sometimes win at faro, often rake in shekels at Monte Carlo, speculate on the stock exchange, bet on a horse race and get your money back, and more. But a book count deal in cattle has always proved disastrous." The owner of a Montana cattle company who received outside investors' capital became obligated to those investors to produce as much profit as possible, no matter what the consequences to the land or to the animals on it. Even though this might require keeping a herd on a range that was in poor condition, it could not possibly humanely support those cattle. Clearly, the thinking of those running cattle on the Montana prairies was short-term, though the periodicals and books of the time claimed the beef boom could go on indefinitely. There was simply no government or private mechanism for regulating the number of animals on any range. The boom years of the Montana open range cattle industry were from 1880 through 1885. But by the end of the hot, dry summer of 1886, the grass on most of the Montana ranges had been destroyed by harsh weather and prolonged overgrazing. The survival of the open range cattle through the winter depended on there being adequate, nutritious, cured grass under the snow so they could rustle, that is to paw down through the snow to reach the cured grass. The dire situation was compounded by low cattle market prices, so that many stockmen decided to hold more animals over the winter, hoping for a better price the next year, rather than shipping them after the fall beef roundup. The demand on the range was also increased by the presence of more than 1 million sheep, and because of the dry summer, range fires consumed precious grass, often the very best. Despite the overcrowding on the ranges, in the summer of 1886, Montana stockmen continued to bring in tens of thousands more cattle. More cautious Montana cattlemen looked for ways to remove their valuable stock from the depleted ranges of the public domain. Some leased large tracts of grazing land from the Alberta provincial government, and tens of thousands of range cattle were driven north. High-quality range on the large Indian reservation north of the Missouri River and on the Crow Reservation was opened to some stockmen by the United States federal government. In September, the Helena Independent reported, "It is doubtful if the total precipitation, snow and rain, has averaged 2 inches over the whole territory during the past 12 months. The consequence was a season of unprecedented heat and one marked by low streams and lack of irrigating water. All over the territory, the same cry has gone up. The grass on the ranges grew but slimly and cured before its time for lack of moisture. Much depends upon the coming winter." Now, in the fall of 1886, Teddy Blue Abbott was a cowboy working to move cattle of the DHS outfit from overgrazed range in central Montana to nearly pristine range on reservation land north of the Missouri River. 50 years later, he told about what happened that fall and winter of 1886-87. The summer had been very dry, as what grass we had was eaten off before the first snow fell. In November, we had several snowstorms, and I saw the first white owls I have ever seen. The Indians said they were a bad sign. Heap snow coming, very cold. They sure hit it right. We had 2 weeks of nice weather just before Christmas, but on Christmas Eve, it started to storm and never really let up for 60 days. It got colder and colder. The latter part of January, it started a Chinook, just enough to melt the snow on top. But it turned cold, and on February 3rd and 4th, the worst blizzard I ever saw set in. The snow crusted, and it was hell without the heat. I wrote to Granville Stewart telling him I thought the loss would not be over 10%. In 10 days, I know it was 75%. When the Chinook finally arrived in early March, it was too late to save the open range cattle. Coulees were filled with animals that had moved into them seeking shelter and had gone no farther. Barbed wire fences stretching across the paths of storm-drifting cattle proved to be death traps. The spring roundups of 1887 showed that the actual loss of cattle surpassed the most pessimistic estimates. Losses varied by region, with authenticated cases of mortality up to 90% on the Yellowstone. Conrad Coors believed the average loss on the prairies of the Eastern Territory was about 50%. In the sheltered Western valleys, losses were much less. Different classes of animals survived at different rates. It was found that Texas steers that had spent several previous winters on the Montana range had the best survival rate of all classes of cattle. The Oregon cattle had been brought in from an area that had cold winters, but there were many cows and calves which did not survive well, so overall mortality was high. Granville Stewart estimated a 66% loss for his herds, which were almost all Oregon cattle. The purebred cattle that had been shipped in from the Midwest on the railroad and turned loose on the range were almost a total loss because of their tendency to hang around the ranch buildings waiting to be fed instead of rustling for grass under the snow. Milk cows and bulls did not survive well either. Although Chicago prices were still low, many Montana cattle outfits seeking to blunt the financial impact of the disaster shipped every marketable animal, but the receipts were not enough to meet their financial obligations. European and Eastern investors, suddenly aware that the beef boom could go bust with one terrible winter, withdrew what was left of their investments. Many cattle companies went out of business. The venerable Niobrara Cattle Company failed, as did the huge Swan Land and Cattle Company in Wyoming. As the cattle companies lost their outside capital or failed completely, cattle company owners who had fretted nervously for years about how they could ever reconcile the inflated book counts to the actual number of cattle in their herds were provided with a sort of grim golden opportunity. They could simply write off to mortality all the non-existent animals in their book counts and thus reconcile their book counts to reality. Despite the disaster, the hard winter created opportunities for those who would seize them. The water from the melting winter snow and from adequate spring rains rejuvenated the range, and the grass came back. The death of hundreds of thousands of cattle had eliminated the problem of overgrazing. For those who would buy cattle, there were thousands for sale at bargain prices from companies that were folding. Now, it is surprising that by the end of the 1880s, there were as many cattle in Montana as there had been just before the hard winter. Herds of Longhorn steers were brought in from Texas by rail and trail into the 20th century. Purebred stock cattle came by rail from the Midwest. The Columbia Basin, however, contributed little to this restocking of the Montana range, as its huge reserve of cattle had been exhausted. Now, of the cattle companies that stayed in business, there were two basic types. Some chose to continue running Longhorn steers on the open range because they had survived well in the hard winter. These open range Texas steer operations continued in eastern Montana until after 1910, when competition from incoming homesteaders claiming pieces of the public domain finally forced them to quit. The other type of cattle operation in the years after the hard winter was a smaller outfit operating on mostly privately held fenced land. These small stockmen bred and raised purebred cattle, typically shorthorns at first, which they replaced with Herefords in later years. And in the 20th century, Black Angus cattle became common. Although purebred animals did not survive the hard winter well, they dressed out to yield more and better quality meat, and in the case of the Herefords, were ready for market at an earlier age. These small operators grew irrigated hay and put it up for winter feeding. Later, non-native forage plants such as red top, timothy, clover, and alfalfa were introduced. Prior to the hard winter, it was common for cattlemen to harvest native grass hay to feed their horses during the winter. During the open range years, almost no one put up the hay for his cattle, and with them spread over hundreds of square miles, it would have been impossible to feed them during the winter anyway. Even in mild winters, open range cattle had suffered a type of slow starvation. At first, the small stockmen typically pastured their animals on the open range in the summer and brought them into fenced pastures to be fed during the winter. In later years, their stock was kept in fenced pastures year-round. It was from these small stockmen that the modern Montana cattle industry evolved. Now, it's remarkable to me that in the 1880s, with most of eastern Montana in open range, the country was overgrazed with only 1 million cattle feeding on it. While today, there are more than 2.5 million cattle in the state of Montana. It is the cultivation and storage of high-quality hay that has made this miracle possible. Today, cattle raising is an important Montana industry with yearly gross receipts of some $1.5 billion. From the perspective of today, we can see that the cattle boom and the hard winter were not the beginning of the end for the Montana cattle industry, but rather the beginning of its future. Thank you.